Thank you very much for the invitation. Thank you also for running this series of talks. I have attended some of them and found them very, very interesting. And thank you also for introducing me to internet policy. I have to say that when I reached MIT, I was a geek. I'm still a geek to some extent. But with you and David and Bill and others that I met there, I saw that we have a lot of common interest on answering important questions. And we start developing a language to talk, and it has been very productive so far. To be honest, this is one of the reasons we start working on this problem. We think that we can bring the analysis of data into the problem of pandemic, but also there are a lot of policy questions that we haven't answered yet, and I'm looking forward to collaborating in the near future. So for you guys, I don't think I have to introduce, you know, why this problem is important. Actually, the fact that you are sitting in your offices and your houses and attending this talk, it's the best motivation I can find why we have to care about the impact of the pandemic of the internet traffic. I have to say that I'm giving this talk, but this is a joint effort of many, many people. So around February last year, we came together to analyze data from a lot of different vantage points in the internet and try to understand what really happens, right? So you see a fantastic team of people from many institutions from different countries. So there is the Max Planck Institute for Informatics in Saarbrücken. Benox, it's a startup that actually it's a spin-off, to be more precise, from Deutsche Telekom Laboratories that I was involved in setting up in around 2012. So this is a work of a couple of PhD students in our group. At that time, Anya Fellman was also in Teubingen and Deutsche Telekom Labs. They developed some very smart ways for ISPs and CDNs to talk together and redirect traffic in an optimal way. And of course, this has evolved over the years. Now, their main focus is actually analytics, and there are many networks in Europe and the US, and also in some IXPs. I'm going to explain more about this in the next slides. They do a fantastic work. So this is an example of how, you know, some ideas from the academia, if it's enough patience and there is some support also from external funding, it can actually go and become a successful startup. Then there's collaboration with DECIX. DECIX is one of the big IXPs. This is where the different networks meet and exchange traffic. For the audience that does not have a technical background, I will provide later a couple of slides to explain why this is so important. And then we have people from Spain that help us to get some more data. And of course, some other colleagues like Oliver and me that we help also with the analysis. I have to say that this is an ongoing work. So we have analyzed data until summer, from the beginning of the pandemic until summer. We are currently working on data for the second wave of the pandemic, which is ongoing in Europe. In some parts of the world, actually, it's a third wave, or it will be a second wave or a third wave this month. So this is still work in progress. And what I'm going to describe to you here, it's biased on what is actually happening in Europe and the US. So there are other parts of the world that we don't have a clear view. We plan to collaborate with other colleagues and also with internet society at some point to get also a feeling of what's happening in places where it's more difficult to get access to data, where the internet is very different than what we see in the West world. Okay, so with this, let me start the main part of the talk. So the web really has changed our life. We all use the internet more and more for retail and the entertainment, and also increasingly we use it to socialize, right? So of course, this has increased during the pandemic. And some people are so dependent on the internet that they start to worry that can go wrong, right? And they may lose data, they may lose access to information, etc. On the other hand, for me, it's also a blessing because now we have infrastructure in place that we can actually solve some of the problems that the pandemic creates. So just think the case that the pandemic like this that we are in now has been the case like 20 years ago, right? So 20 years ago, we didn't have credit cards. We didn't have a way to buy things online. We didn't have entertainment at home. We didn't even have DSL, right? So, of course, we rely more and more on the internet. But at the same time, we have spent all these decades building a very sophisticated infrastructure, okay, machines, servers, and payment systems that can actually can be useful now. I think there's some noise. Okay. So I just put this question because this will motivate some of the things that we see also in the traffic. And of course, don't expect that the pandemic go away very soon. So of course there is a vaccine, but until the vaccine will reach a significant part of the population, this may take years, right? And already now companies start informing their employees that they should work remotely. They actually encourage them to work remotely. And this may change even the way that we live. So some things are here to stay. So it is possible that the office space that we know, especially in some parts of the world, like big cities in the US or cities in Europe, Asia, will completely change, right? So maybe companies will not want any more their employees to be, you know, in the office. And then, you know, we have to see how this traffic will actually move at the edge of the network, right? So we have to think of how we can move from a protected enterprise environment to something that is more like a ubiquitous environment where users can work at home or can move to different countries or different cities, right? So this is a big, big challenge for the next years. Now, when the pandemic started, many people went back to their textbooks or to some of the analysis that has been done for previous pandemics or previous events, and they tried to understand what happened, right? So there is a very famous report about SARS and also some of the implications that SARS had. But, you know, this was quite different because SARS didn't really have a big effect globally. It had more like an effect in some part of the world, especially in Asia. So all these what-if scenario were in place, we really didn't know what's happening, right? The second thing is that because of the new administration in the US, many of the defenses that were in place for crises like that actually weren't any more active. In Europe, we had the problem that because we have this strange system, we didn't have also ways to react to this pandemic. So for many people and for many economies, and even for the technological people, this was something new. So we started in February, around February, March, to get questions from all our friends, colleagues. Okay, what about the internet? Can it survive? Right. And then you had people that ask these questions. And of course, you have journalists that start answering the question. And most of the times, you know, this is like in an ad hoc way, right? So there was a fear that, you know, the internet can collapse, right? And if this collapses, then you have other problems. Because if the internet collapses, then a series of business sectors may be affected. And of course, there were people like David Clark and people from Google that they have built this system. They say, look, we created this system to survive a nuclear war, why it should not survive a pandemic. So we had this debate, but we lack hard evidence. We lack data to analyze and see what's happening. And of course, for that, we're more like into the internet measurement community. The big question is, what is the user activity shift? So just to give you a background, the last 20 years in the internet, we have seen tectonic changes. So For the older of you, you may remember peer-to-peer, right? So if you ask now, say, a student at Berlin probably does know what peer-to-peer is, does know what BitTorrent is, right? But 15 years ago, when I was younger, if you want to download a movie, you have to download with a peer-to-peer system. And this put a lot of stress, for example, to ISPs. So overnight, suddenly, links, peering links, and the ISPs were filled with traffic that was exchange of packets to download a video. And this was a big problem. So at that point, we said, okay, everybody's doing peer-to-peer. Then it was the time of CDN. So the peer-to-peer traffic disappeared over a period of a couple of years. And we have CDN traffic, which to some extent is still the case. And big companies like Google, Akamai, Yahoo at some point, they have servers all over the world and they deliver content. And we reached the point that 80-90% of the traffic was CDN traffic. And this, of course, took some years to see this change. And now we have that overnight people leave their offices, they move at home, and we don't know what's happening, right? So this is probably the third wave of user activity shift in the last. And as I will show you later, the changes are rapid. So things that we expect to see within a year, within three years, happen actually within weeks. And this was the question. The question is, can the current architecture of the internet and the current investment in the infrastructure sustain this? Okay, so what we did is what we actually know to do, to go to our friends and ask for data. So first, we went to friends that have data from a big ISP. And then we went also to some other friends that have access from the same network, I have to say, but about mobile users, right? And to give you the scale, this is actually in Europe, right? We're talking about some country in Europe. Let's just give you the scale. For the ISP, we have access to about activity of 15 million households, right? And this network is a very big network. 15 million is not 15 million users, 15 million households, right? So you, every household may have between 2 and 4 people. And this network is also a big tier one provider, which means it also handles traffic not only for the end users, the subscribers for this network, but also for smaller companies and some data centers and some other companies that are related to, you know, IT sector. So we also got data for 40 million subscribers of the mobile operator. Now, I don't want to go down to the details of what this data is. Maybe, I mean, for those of you that you are familiar with this type of data, it's net flow data. But for those that you are not in the technical sector, it's enough to tell you that it's data that tells you how much traffic goes from servers to end user or from end user to a server, right? So you see how the traffic pretty much flows within the network. So what's the destination? What is the source of the traffic? And of course, there is some anonymization because we don't really want to know what each individual user does, but we would like to see the trend, right? So how the things have shifted during this period. Okay. This is one set that we use. The second set is actually from IXPs. So IXPs, as I said, are the locations where different networks meet, right? So before, in the ISP or in the wireless, we have pretty much a view of what's happening at the edge of the internet, right? So we are talking about not the last hop, the link that goes actually to the house, but maybe, you know, one or two hops before that. So we're talking about aggregation points like neighborhoods, cities, this level. Now to the IXPs, we're talking about the core of the internet. This is where the different networks exchange traffic. So this is actually very interesting because you see the same phenomenon, right, which is the impact of the COVID, but from different parts of it, right? So we don't want to have a focus only at the edge or only at the core. We want to have like a complementary view, if you want. Now, for this, we use three locations. One of them is actually a very big IXP, which is in Europe. It has traffic of 8. Now it's actually more close to 10 terabps. This is huge. Just to give you a scale of what we are talking about, is like, think of a single building or somewhere in Europe that exchanges as much traffic as, for example, a big player like Deutsche Telekom in all over the world, right? So Deutsche Telekom has presence in multiple locations around the world. And you have one location that exchanges similar traffic. Okay, it's not like a Deutsche Telekom, but similar in terms of level. And you have more than 900 networks of any type you can think of, like residential network, data centers, governments, you name it, that exchange traffic in this location, right? Then we have another one which is in South Europe and which is smaller, has 170 networks that exchange traffic. That's significant because especially in the beginning of the pandemic, there was a lot of attention of what happens in South Europe, like Italy, Spain, you know, those were the, unfortunately, the places where pandemic first hit, at least in Europe, right? And then to get also a better view of what's happened globally, we have access to a big IXP in the East Coast. It's close to New York. It's actually quite big. It's like 250 networks connecting there. Now, for those of you that you are not very familiar with the IXP, I just put a few slides, so just stay with me for a few minutes, even if you know what an IXP is, because it's important to understand why it's important not only to know what's happening at the IXP, right, but also at the IXP. So at the IXP level, if you have a problem with your connection, you may call, for example, the hotline, then we try to find the solution. In the IXP, the things are a little bit more complicated because they are not only the end users, they are networks, and these networks have thousands or even millions of users that depend on this. So this is pretty much what is the ecosystem out there. We have about 400 locations that host IXPs. We are talking about 125 terabps of traffic. This is approximately 15% of the internet traffic today. And you have millions of peerings. So for you that you are interested about how the traffic there connects, in Europe, a significant part of traffic flows through these facilities. In the US, not so much. In Latin America, it's increasing. You know, so there is a significant part of the traffic that actually is exchanged there. And these places have become very important the last 5 to 10 years because these exchange points, these IXPs, are also co-located with data centers. So here I show you the facility in London. This is Lynx that hosts thousands of data of servers, actually hundreds of thousands of interconnections, which means that if this goes down, then we have a problem, right? So a lot of data will not be accessible. You have shift of traffic. And also many networks that connect there are not only networks in London, but there might be networks all over UK or maybe all over the world, right? So maybe, for example, a Malaysian ISP exchange traffic in London with US customers or with US networks. And of course, this has increased in significance the last year. So here I show you the metro of London. So you have 10 locations where these IXPs are located, and then they are interconnected with other IXPs in different parts of UK, for example, in Manchester, Scotland, and even in the US. So you, by connecting there, you can even exchange traffic, for example, with somebody in North Virginia, because North Virginia also is a center of data centers, and government data centers are also there. So you know, any impact that you may have in some place may also impact something in the US, right? So things have become so interconnected that we really have to understand if, for example, pandemic creates a problem somewhere, what will be the impact somewhere else? Okay. Now, for this importance, these facilities have been characterized as critical infrastructure. So they are in the same level with nuclear reactors, with the water system, electricity system, etc. And in most of the cases, they have to have an availability of 4/9 or 5/9. So for example, in the case of 5/9, we're talking about downtime of 5 minutes per year. So if, for example, a pandemic creates a problem that will last for hours, this is already bad. Companies will pay penalties. Data may be lost, and other things may go wrong. Right? The same, to some extent, is the case for ISPs, but there the liability is a little bit different because there are end customers involved and not so much other companies. And of course, we have some idea of how things can go wrong. For all of you that you may remember the 9/11 attack, in the 9/11 attack, in the basement of the Twin Towers, there was a data center that hosted a lot of critical infrastructure like DNS servers, routers. Some of these actually were of telecommunication organizations outside the US. So when the building collapsed, because of the weight and after the crash, right? Many telecommunication points actually lost connectivity, data were lost, data centers had to relocate somewhere else, UPS stopped working after a few hours. And at that time, the internet was much smaller and we didn't really rely so much on the internet, right? So if things go wrong now, the impact will be severe. And actually, we have even recent cases. For example, there was an outage in Amsterdam in 2015, where for a human error, all the traffic were lost, and then the impact was actually mirrored in Frankfurt. Right, and took a few hours to actually balance the traffic and see what's happening. Okay, so let's now go back to the initial setting we had for the study of the pandemic. So we have, just to summarize, we had ISP data, we had mobile data, and we have IXP data. And take all this traffic, you want to see what's actually happened, and actually if the internet can sustain this, right? Now, here I plot what happened in the ISP. So just to recall, this is a big network of about 15 million users, VDSL users, but DSL also. As you can see here, in x-axis, we have the weeks of the different years. So here is January 1st, here is 31st of December 2019, and here's 2020. So for you that you have studied traffic pollution, you recognize this. So this is the typical increase that you see in a network within a year. So you expect, with of course some monthly variability that has to do with, for example, how significant is a month, if it's a summer or a winter, you see an overall increase of 30%, right? And actually this is what you see here. So for privacy purposes, we have normalized everything. So you start about 0.78, you end up somewhere a little bit above one, right? So this is a 30%, this is perfectly normal. And this increases, so it follows a trajectory, right? Until this point here, right? So this point is actually where the World Health Organization clear the pandemic. So there is an official way that you say that it's a pandemic. And this was about the time that also the government of this country decided to lock down the economy, right? To shut down the economy. Of course, you may see a little bit difference because not everybody, you know, went home immediately. But, you know, this is the point that you actually see a rapid increase. And this increase alone is 30% or close to 30%. It's between, let's say, 15 and 30%. So what you see, for example, for a year increase, you may see it within a few weeks. Right. So the first observation is that if you don't provision your network, right? So if you run hot in the normal period, or if you want to save money and you follow this 30% rule of thumb, you have a problem. Right? This is very obvious. So not with our data, but with some collaboration we have, we saw that some of the networks that are known to run hot, they had problems exactly at this point, right? Because you hit really the capacity of what you can achieve, right? But if you are a good citizen and you have a provision of 50%, actually most of the networks that respect themselves, they have something like they never exceed 50% utilization. And the reason is first, queuing will harm the quality of experience, right? So you don't really want to for queue. Also, you know that if there is a routing problem, or if there is an attack, or even a failure, everything should be able to get the traffic of another link, right? So in the worst case, you have to run half capacity. So if another link fails, then you get the capacity. Of course, you reach again 100%, but you don't reach 120%, right? Actually, many ISPs operate even below 50%. Like, it's not unusual to see that ISPs operate between, I don't know, 30 and 40%. Okay, then you see that how there is this peak. I call this, and this is my opinion, it's not the opinion of the my colleagues, my co-authors, but I think this is a panic period, right? So people didn't know what to do, you know. They say, okay, you have to work from home. So overnight you go home and you do exactly what you used to do in the office, right? And then things go down a little bit. And then after some point, part of the economy opens again. And then things go back to where the trajectory would actually lead you if you just follow this 30% rule of thumb. Okay, so things to remember, we have a real increase here of 30% as we expect. A peak here within weeks, which is as significant as this, but in principle, you should be able to react to this. Now, let's see what's happened with the IXPs. IXPs is a little bit different case because IXPs, because they are centralized, they can amortize increases much better, right? Because for an ISP, if an ISP wants to increase the capacity, it has to go to every location and increase the capacity. It should have people in the field, right, to actually tune things. In the IXP, typically, you have a centralized infrastructure. You have capacity per member. And then if the member operates close to the capacity of the port, as they call it, they say, okay, I can give you another port. So you can actually increase the capacity much faster. It's much more flexible to increase. And there is also the economy of scale. Like, so IXP in a sense is like a cloud, right? You have a huge pool of resources, right? And then you allocate them on demand. So IXPs typically run in a much lower utilization than an ISP. So an IXP can run in utilization, I don't know, 10% basically, 20% maximum, right? So that's why they can amortize better peak of traffic, attacks, etc. So here we do exactly the same analysis for the three IXPs that we have. Remember, two are in Europe and one is in the US. And you see that more or less the story is the same, right? So you have a trajectory, right? Then you have the peak, and then except one, right? And this is because this is a relatively small IXP. The two other, which are the big ones, are actually keep a little bit higher level than the ISP, right? So it seems that the traffic increased and stayed for some time there, at least from what we have analyzed. Now, if you go to the mobile operator, it's a little bit different story. So you have, again, the 30%, right? Here is Christmas, nobody works, fine. And then, actually, nobody answers the phone, maybe, because this can be somebody that calls from the office. And then you have, again, 30%, and then nothing, like a plateau here. Actually, it's a decrease. So one of the reasons is that when you are staying at home, you don't necessarily have a lot of communication, right, with your office or other. Or you can just switch to Wi-Fi. So a lot of mobile traffic actually moves to Wi-Fi. And when they were relaxed in the restrictions, then you see that the traffic starts increasing again. And again, you can fit this 30% rule of thumb. Okay. So let's now go a little bit into details. And for this, I will focus on what happened in the ISP. Okay. So here I show you what is, I would consider a normal week in the life of an ISP. So just to read it, this is Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. And here again, for obvious reasons, we have normalized the traffic. So this is in Europe, 20th of February 2020 until 26th of February 2020. So as you can see, you have people are sleeping, wake up, peak time, and this repeats. Now, for those of you that you see a little bit more detail of what's happening, you see that the pattern of a weekday is different than the pattern of the weekend, right? Weekend day, like Saturday or Sunday. So during the weekday, like Monday to Friday, you see that there is a more steep increase, you know, in the evening. Okay. And a fall, of course. In the weekend, this is a little bit more progressive, right? Because people may stay at home, you know, they do different things. And then this increase again. So the peak time is always the same, but the way that you reach this peak time differs. And also the level of the peak time also is different. Actually, Saturday evening, it's good that people are out. Sunday, they remember that they have an important meeting on the day, so they start working, right? Okay, so let's see what happened when the pandemic was actually in the first weeks, at least in Europe. So you see that there is an increase also in the peak. Right, it's not 30%, but it's around 5-6%, maybe a little more. In the weekend, it's even more. Why? Because these people that used to go out, now they have to stay at home. And then you see this curve, you see this curve everywhere. So it's not only in the weekend, but it's everywhere. Right. And you have this 30% increase, especially in the weekend. But again, you see that the maximum, it's not that far from the maximum that you had, for example, during the week, right, before. So this is 30% the Saturday, but this is like 6%. Now, why this is important? If you are a network operator, you don't optimize the network for the total traffic. You optimize the network for the peak. So this is a historic thing, but also it's also reflect to the way that you purchase equipment, you purchase capacity, etc. So you want really to be good at the worst case scenario, not at the best case scenario. So here, if this increases 30%, this doesn't mean that you violate anything. So if you have provisioned your network like 10% more than the usual peak, you are covered by this, right? Now, why I say that? Because you may have heard in the news, oh, we see a 200% increase in the traffic, right? Now, one thing is that you have an increase of 200% of 30% or 50%. The other thing is where it happens. So if it happens here in the valley, doesn't matter, right? The problem is if it happens here. So if this has been here, then we have a problem. Okay, so let's see now in April. So in April, about the same thing. Note that there is always a fluctuation also because of the time of the year. For example, around April, sometimes the traffic was lower because, for example, there was Easter, right? So this has also some effect. But as you can see, the peak is, again, not that higher than usual. And then in June, it's actually go down. So pretty much the stress was somewhere here, somewhere between March and April. Okay, now this is, if you want, a macroscopic view. So we see here somehow on a daily snapshot what's happening. What we also did is we want to go a little bit inside and see the details per hour, right? Because as I told you, if you want to provision your network or if you want to see how the user activity shifts, you have to really see which part of the day is actually creating the problem, right? So here, this is what we did in detail. So in the x-axis, you see the 24 hours of a day of Wednesday before the pandemic, right? And then this is a Saturday before the pandemic. Recall that this is a residential network, right? So why blue is lower here? Because people are not at home, right? They're in the office, so of course the traffic is lower. Then on Saturday, people stay home, do things, watch TV, watch YouTube. The peak doesn't change too much, but the valley is actually higher in the weekend than actually during a work day, right? Because there are more people at home, basically. And this is what's happening in lockdown. So in the lockdown, you see that, again, you feel this part, which is the valley, and the peak is almost unaffected, right? Now, there was some question, actually, Volker also asked, okay, can this be because you reach the capacity? So we tried to see the data, and because we had also the capacity information, this is not that you reach the capacity, it's actually, there's still a lot of capacity. It's mainly because as a human being, this is how much traffic can consume, right? We talk also with ISPs in the US because we thought this might be very specific to Europe. You know, there is so many gigabytes that you can consume. Even if you put YouTube high resolution, you know, how much videos you can see, right? Of course, I'm not saying that they are not pathetic cases or corner cases where there are, I don't know, 10 people at home and you share one Wi-Fi, but if you see that aggregation of millions, right, of customers, then this is what you see. And you see this strange phenomenon that in the lockdown, the traffic, depending on which time of the day you see, which day you see it, for the same time of day, it looks more like weekend than weekday. Right? So if your provisioning is that I can handle weekend well, during the pandemic, you will not have a problem. This is the bottom line. And to make sure that we don't, okay, this is something visual, right? So I show you something and I ask you to believe, right? So we did one more thing. We try to correlate the different traffic. So we try to correlate the traffic of each day, a typical, let's say, pattern for the same time during the weekday, let's say Monday to Friday, and during the weekend. Okay, so now you have to be with me here to explain what I mean. So here I plot something if it looks like weekend, right? And here I plot something if it looks like working, like Monday to Friday, okay? And if it's weekend and looks like weekend, I have the blue color. If it's weekend and looks like weekday, I put the orange. And here I do the opposite. If it looks like weekday, I put the blue. If it looks like weekend, like the opposite than the real day, I put orange. Okay, so we start from January until February of 2020, and then you see something like that. Okay, so when you see blue, this means that the classifier, right, that says this day looks like weekday or weekend, actually weekend or weekday, actually agrees. You see, when it's up during the weekend with blue color, it's good. When it's down during the weekday and it's blue, it's good. So you see a nice symmetry here, 5 days Monday to Friday, 2 days weekend. Monday to Friday, weekend. Okay, there is one exception here, fine. But then you start seeing something like that. So except very few cases, the profile has completely shifted. So it, depending on what day you are during the weekdays, Monday to Friday, the pattern is weakened, right? And then somewhere in mid of May, you go back to the previous pattern, but because you still have some restrictions, you start seeing this not so symmetric pattern that you see here, but you see, you know, some days somehow it's misclassified, right? What you see. So this is the ISP, and remember that this is what you expect. This is the stress period, and this is what you get after the relaxation. We don't know where we are now, so this is actually what we try to check. But I expect that if you want this transient behavior, will actually continue for months. So I will not be surprised. I'm not saying that this is the case, but I will not be surprised if it looks like this. Basically. Now, if you see the IXP, you see a completely different view. You see that you moved to this, I would call it endless weekend period, and you stay there. Right. So this means that some things that happen in the IXP or in data centers are actually there to stay. So it seems that during this stress period, a lot of applications have moved to the cloud, and for obvious reasons, for example, flexibility of resources, scalability, etc. It was easier to find actually capacity, right? Because there was already enough capacity there. There was enough peering links. And the recent years, there have been significant developments in how you can automate this process. So if you are in a big IXP, if you want to connect to networks, you don't call an engineer to go in two routers and interconnect them. They're actually mechanical robots, right, that have different possible positions that can plug things, and they go and do this work for you. So it's completely automated. So if you want, at least in Europe, in the US, 100 gigabits connection, you can have it within minutes. Right. Now, something that we didn't study, but we talk with other people that have access to this type of data, is that we see also a significant difference from where the data or the content flows. So if you are an ISP, you may have what we call local caches, right? So you have servers that are inside your network. For example, Netflix has this, or Google has the Google Global Cache that are installed within your network, and they give you traffic to the user. Why this is good? Because it's closer to the user. Okay, you don't have to cross the ISP boundaries, right? So this is not only closer, but for example, you may avoid congestion, and it's also dedicated for the users of the ISP. Right? So if you are, for example, AT&T, you may say, okay, I have eight caches of Google within AT&T, so I'm going to serve my customers from these caches instead of going to, for example, an IXP and get the content. So before the pandemic, what is called this off-net was about responsible for about 2/3 of the traffic. Right. So, and 1/3 is actually coming from the peering or the IXP or some private connection, whatever. Now, during the pandemic, because actually they couldn't scale this up, because you have to send people to install caches, you have to do agreements, this was much more difficult. So the percentage actually increased, but only a few. And what you see here is pretty much a double. Why? Because it's much easier to actually scale this part than this part. So although in the beginning of the pandemic, this was a blessing because you already have capacity within your network. So obviously you can serve more users and more traffic than this guy that is a little bit further away. That's because this is not so scalable. You have actually to scale this part, and this was scalable. The IXP part. Now, of course, there are more details. I'm going for the next maybe 5 minutes to go a little bit more in some how the applications somehow changed. Here, we saw again for the ISP, the classes of the different traffic within this ISP. You have conferenc, you have collaboration working applications, email, video on demand, gaming, social media, education, CDN, etc. And as you can see, you know, different applications have different activity during the week, right? Web conferenc, as you can see, is not that popular. This is the week actually before the lockdown. So we only use some web conferenc tool, but you know, we definitely prefer to go to the next office and talk to somebody or even travel for a conferenc, right? Now, this is what happens in March. So remember March, this was mid of March, this is already a lockdown. So we are somewhere here before, like in the yellow area, now we are in the red area, right? So this is actually 200% increase. So, you know, in the public media, they said, oh, 200% increase of traffic, probably they refer to something like this. Yes, for example, if you have, I don't know, Cisco WebEx, Google Teams, et cetera, you are somewhere here. Email increased, not so much. Social media increased, education, of course, increased. And now you see this, video on demand decreased, right? Why? Because there was this gentleman's agreement, we are going to reduce the quality of the high definition video, for example, Netflix, et cetera, right? So you actually see this in the data. Yes, there was decrease. So next April, you know, about the same phenomenon, right? And then June, you know, a little bit less. So it seems that the web conferenc went a little bit down, video on demand somehow normalized a little bit, email the same, etc. So it seems that after June, we are in this transient period that things can go a little bit higher than usual, but not that much. Except maybe from the web conferenc and the education, everything else is more or less back to normal. Now, of course, there are many other things. We published a paper in IMC this year. I highly recommend if you want to check all the details to see this paper. We also invited to the Internet Architecture Advisory Board of ITF to present our work. Just I want to finish maybe this presentation with some other thoughts. So far I talked to you about the impact on the internet traffic. There are many other things that are happening. Some of them, we have some results. For some of them, it's still a work in progress. But one thing that we saw that has a dramatic increase of about 10% is VPN traffic. Right? So this is actually very important traffic. It's not so much traffic compared to the overall traffic, but it's important because this is the way that remote workers connect to servers like email and other secure servers. And this can be under attack, right? So if you get access to this VPN, then you can actually do very nasty things. This is something that attracted the attention of policymakers. Companies like Akamai give now solutions just for VPN, right? And especially the stress period, we saw a 200% increase. We saw also a lot of things that look like attack. Other research have reported attacks just for this traffic, right? Because you are not, again, you are not in this protective enterprise environment, so you're at home. So if somebody gets access to this, it has an advantage. And this actually attracted attention also of security agencies in UK and the US. The Five Eyes countries already have reports about this. We have seen a lot of increase in phishing and malware. Just to give you some examples, there were a lot of malicious users that actually registered domains that look like COVID so they can attract traffic and then you can put malware. There have been also reports even for very popular websites. For example, the website that was reporting the number of deaths in some country, right? So everybody goes there. So if you can manipulate the way that you reach this website, or if you have access to the servers of this website, then you can install, you know, whatever you want there and get information of the users. So this is actually an increasing concern. Of course, these agencies have ways to react to this, but this is an ongoing fight. So we see, you know, that malicious users come back with different domains, with different techniques, and probably this is something that is here to stay. So although we didn't see a huge impact on the traffic, so I don't consider the traffic as a big problem, at least for this type of pandemic. The upper layer or the security part, it's still a big problem, and it's here to stay for some time. Okay, so to conclude, we saw an overall traffic increase of 30% within a few weeks. This is something that it should have taken place within a year. And the message is, if you have a well-provisioned network, probably you will not have a problem. If you are one of the smaller players in the market, or you run hot, then you definitely felt some of this pressure. The good thing is that the increase in the traffic was actually not typical on the peak period. Right? So you didn't have to run hot to see the impact. Now, so we have tools for network provision, we have cloud, IXPs, automation. If the pandemic had happened, let's say 10 years ago, we'll have a completely different setting. There is also significant increase in applications, especially applications that have to do with remote working, and those are critical applications. And something that's still ongoing, but I don't have so many results for you right now, is security problems. And with this, I would like to conclude the talk. Thank you very much for your attention.